Good evening. I'm Vincent Price, and I've got a secret.
See, take a shot with this camera and look at the names over here. I came in here the other day before the panelists got in. I thought the panelists were Pat Henry and Anita Richard. I didn't know who the heck to look for. Anyway, fortunately, we have a very impressive comedian, Miss Pat Carroll. It's a lovely dress you're wearing, incidentally. And the wily, witty Prince of Chastisement himself, Henry Morgan. The accomplished young actress, lovely Anita Gillette. And a man from whom no secret is safe, Inspector Richard Dawson. There's our panel. We will welcome tonight's first contestant as we open the Great Wall. Here he is. Nice to have you with us, sir. Would you tell the panel your name?
My name is Oliver A. Jolly Bachelor.
Jolly Bachelor. Where are you from, Mr. Bachelor?
From Claremont, California.
Panel, it's Professor Bachelor. There's a little hint for you. He's a teacher at Cal Poly in Pomona, California, and he commutes there each day in this car, as you see here. And his secret concerns this special attachment, we want to be very plain with you, that you can see on the back of the car. And let's see if we can just step back just a bit, Professor. There we are. The viewers at home can now get a good look at it, too. And I'll just tell you an additional hint. It utilizes heat from the engine. So if you'll whisper what that attachment is all about, Professor, we'll let the audience know. Very well, panel. The audience now knows what Professor Bachelor's secret is. It's a special attachment that relates to that, I should say, that functions while he's driving. And we'll start the questioning with Anita.
Oh, Mr. Jolly Bachelor. Is that really your name, Jolly Bachelor? I love that. I know a lot of Jolly Bachelors. Mr.
I'm sorry, your time is up, Anita, but you're right.
Mr. Jolly Bachelor, does that have anything to do with cleaning up the air?
Not particularly, no.
That's
no.
Certainly not its purpose. It could possibly do it a little bit, but that's not
what
you're
looking for. Does it have something to do with more fun? Something that's really fun?
Definitely fun.
Yeah?
Yes.
Does it make a noise?
Oh, no.
It doesn't make a noise.
We gave you a yes on fun, but it could mislead you.
Oh, it could mislead me. Is it then something that's very useful?
Oh, extremely useful.
Does it help conserve gas?
No.
No, I wouldn't say that. One down, three to go. Richard?
Professor... I noticed that it's on the exhaust pipe. Yes. Is that just to stabilize it, or are you using the exhaust?
Well, that is part of the suspension, but I use the exhaust. Mm-hmm.
Are you sending threatening smoke signals to Indians?
No.
Is there something that goes on the top of the chimney-like affair there?
Yes, there really could be another part to it.
Is it a bubble machine of some kind, made with hot air?
No.
What do you think of the idea, Professor?
You may build one.
Work on it during the vacation.
Two down, Pat Carroll.
Professor Jolly Bachelor, does it have anything to do with a fuel? I mean, does it make you go in a fun kind of useful way? Whoopee!
No, not necessarily.
Is it where you stash your booze?
No.
Does it have to do with going faster?
No.
Does it have to do with anything that happens while you're driving? I mean, does a signal, not the smoke signal, but does any kind of thing happen while
you're driving? Happens while you're driving.
Something happens while you're driving.
Okay, Henry, it's up to you.
You cooking your lunch in there?
Yes, you've got it.
Wait a minute.
Yes, Henry.
I get another chance because I'm just kidding.
Don't You know, a funny thing, Henry often knocks them off very fast, and the reason is, besides his obvious intelligence, he has been a panelist, and I've got a secret on and off for about 10 years, as an experience shows. Anyway, the professor's secret, as we've now figured out, is that this attachment in his car is an oven, and it cooks, as Richard was suggesting, with heat from the engine. It's very remarkable, and when he gets home, it's his wife who says, hey, what's for dinner? You know. How does the thing work, specifically?
Well, actually, I'm using the heat from the engine. I take one-third of the fuel that's used to drive the engine, comes out as exhaust heat.
I never heard of gas that gives you food before, I'll tell you that. Think about the folks and try, your time is up.
At 20 miles an hour, I get 260 degrees. At 65 miles an hour, I get 600 degrees. Oh. And I have cooked a meal coming in here today.
That's remarkable. We're going to be able to look at it in just a moment. The fumes never reach the food, do they?
Never. No, it's cleaner than your kitchen oven.
I'm not surprised at that. If Jane will forgive me. Could we take a peek at that? See just how the thing works?
Now, you see, the exhaust fumes pass around this and heat it. Mm-hmm. Inside, there are 10 hot biscuits.
Is that why?
You have a very well-balanced diet.
And they really are hot.
Thank you.
Very just good. A minute. This is Rommel's glasses. What the heck?
Now look what's over here, gang.
And on this side, I have Cornish game hen.
Oh, you're
kidding. Oh, wow.
You have many road-tested recipes?
Yes, quite a number. The biscuits I cook at 55 and then brown them at 60.
I like that.
Oh, wow.
And then the gourmet sweet potatoes.
Wow.
Well,
what's for dinner? I'll just pop something in the car and drive around the block.
I'll run down to Colonel Sanders, and by the time I get back, I won't even have to go. What did I say?
It's very interesting. You know, this will make Howard Johnson put itself on wheels. Howard Johnson will chase you down the road.
How many gallons a mile can you get to?
He once got a ticket for doing 45 mile an hour biscuits in a 25 mile zone. We're going to keep trying these jokes, folks. We don't care whether they work or not. I mean, once they're in your mind, you got to get them out of your mouth. How did you get this novel idea, Professor?
We were camping in the Rockies one early June, and a car was made we sleep inside, though it didn't have a tent. So I got out, picked up my stove, and every time I got ready to cook something, it would rain or hail or snow. Well, I had a can of soup that I'd opened, and I put it, I'd backed into the camping spot, and there was a rock right by the exhaust. So I put the can of soup in front of the exhaust pipe, and we got in the car and turned on the heat and kept warm. And when I got out, the soup was hot. And I thought, well, if it'll cook soup in 10 minutes out in the freezing storm, what would it do if I made a jacket around it? So hence started my tailpipe cooker. This is Mark VI model. I made one in New Zealand when we were down there, and it works very well. It's really a gasser.
We've asked you to be standing, panel, because those who were victims of the crime have asked you know, for the opportunity to identify you. Seriously, you're going to participate in the next spot, and we're going to meet a guest who will tell you something quite fascinating. Here he is. Nice to have you with us, sir. Would you tell the panel your name?
Gene Marvin.
And you are from?
Los Angeles.
All right. Ordinarily, panel, you know, you have to guess the secrets of our guests. That's the way the game goes. But tonight, something of a switch. Mr. Marvin is going to turn the tables. He is going to tell us all your secret, so to speak, because he is a performer who does a mind-reading act. He's appearing in Hollywood presently at the Magic Castle. You may have seen him at Playboy clubs around the country, and you will again soon. Mr. Marvin, would you tell us just how we'll go about this?
Yes, I'd like everybody to think of their name, first of all, and think of one thought that's personal to you, not a question, just a thought. And once you have this firmly in your mind, Johnny, if you'll pass out some slips of paper, I'd like you to write your name and a personal thought on that slip of paper.
Incidentally, I suggest you don't make it too personal, panel, because with luck, Mr. Marvin really will be able to blab to the world what it is that you thought of, if he can accomplish this remarkable task he has set for himself. And then in just a moment, I guess we'll have Johnny collect these pieces of paper. What will we do then with them?
When they're finished writing, after they have the name on it and so forth, take the paper off the board, fold it up, insert it into the envelope, and then seal the envelope so I can't possibly see on the inside. I'm also going to put on a pair of gloves.
Why?
People in the past have accused me of being able to feel the ink on the slips of paper through the envelope, so this will certainly prove that that's impossible. Just fold the papers up, insert them into the envelope.
By the way, while we're doing that, how many of you over there are skeptics, panel? Be honest. Henry, we have two or three skeptics. Four skeptics, all right.
Oh, I'm a Presbyterian,
sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. Well, that's very close to skepticism. Now, how about our audience here? How many of you think that Mr. Marvin cannot actually read minds? Put your hand up if you doubt. Well, we have about 30% doubters out there. That's not too bad. Now, how do you intend to pick up the thoughts of our panelists, Mr. Marvin?
Let's just call them one at a time, have them come over, bring your envelope over. I'd like to feel the envelope and your wrist, and at that time, I'll have you concentrate on what's on the inside. Now,
Pat Carroll, want to start out with Pat? Just come right over here, dear, and concentrate on what's in the envelope.
I have to concentrate.
Yes, hold up the envelope so I can touch it, and your wrist. Something that has happened to you in the past, something you received, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Some sort of an award or a degree, is that right, Pat?
Mm-hmm.
I believe it's, the degree is it an honorary degree? It is honorary. Concentrate on the kind it is. Is it possibly some sort of a doctor degree? Is that right? Would it be a doctor of letters degree? Is it an honorary doctor of letters degree that you have? Is that right?
That's absolutely
right. Is that your thought?
Right.
Thank you.
You can keep that as an... Isn't that impressive? All right, skeptic number two, Henry Morgan. Let's see if he has the same luck with you, Henry.
That's right.
Is that
Henry? Some sort of fear on your part. Is that right, Henry?
It's related to fear.
A hatred of some type.
Hatred, hatred, hatred.
Has something to do with height. It's not buildings. Flying.
This place
flying.
Is rigged.
Yes,
this place is
flying.
Rigged.
You hate to fly in airplanes. Is that right?
That's right.
Wow. Fantastic. Henry is nonplussed and perplexed. All right, Anita, just come right over here, dear, with your envelope and your little fist and concentrate on what's in there.
You're thinking of a person, is that right?
Right.
A person very close to you.
Yes.
A relative.
Right.
Possibly, I'm picking up female vibrations, this would be a sister.
Right.
Something has happened to her recently, is that right?
Yes.
Goodness. Back there with a bugle.
And something's going to happen in the near future, too, is
right.
That true?
Yeah.
She's going to have a baby, isn't she? Yes.
Okay, Richard Dawson.
I don't want you to leave any prints. The winner is Anthony Quinn.
No.
All right, concentrate. I see a lot of people in your thought, is that right?
Yes.
People, floats.
Yeah.
Something about parades, that's all I mean. What is your thought?
I love a parade.
You love a parade, all right?
Very good. Terrific. Remarkable demonstration. Mr. Marvin, that's really phenomenal. I would say more, but why bother when you already know what I'm thinking? Thank you for joining us. Very much.
We'll be back with our guest star, Vincent Price, right after these messages.
Before we meet tonight's guest star, Vincent Price, I'd like to tell you something about his secret while our panel is offstage in their soundproof room. Vincent's secret concerns his love for art. I'm sure you know about that. And it involves, what you may not know, a specific famous painting called The Cardinal's Portrait. I'm going to hold up a print of it. The Cardinal's Portrait by Toby Rosenthal, painted many years ago. Brilliant painting. Color photograph of it here. Tonight we are recreating this portrait with living models on our stage, featuring Vincent as the cardinal. And now we'll open the Great Wall, and you'll see this amazing living picture. Here it is. Isn't that absolutely phenomenal? Real living picture. Welcome to the show, Vincent.
Oh, thank you, Steve.
But you thought he wasn't going to move there for a second or two. Could you tell us something about all this?
Well, you know, every summer, the famous Laguna Festival of Arts and Pageant of the Masters in Laguna Beach, huh? California, here, they recreate works of art like this one with live models. And so tonight, with the aid of festival producer Don Williamson and his staff, we've recreated one of the pageant favorites that people come to see from all over the world.
Well, I can certainly see why. Your secret, then, is that you're posing as a living painting. And in just a moment, we're going to bring the panel back, now that we've established that, from the soundproof room, with her blindfold on, of course. Incidentally, while we're waiting for that, I want to congratulate you, Vincent, on another one of your marvelous books. We'll take a close-up of it here with one camera or another. There it is. It's called Vincent Price's Treasury of American Art, and it's really something special. Want to tell us a little about the book?
Oh, thank you. Yeah. You know, I think an awful lot of people don't think there is such a thing as American art because we're made up of so many other people. That's really what I try to prove, that there is a very real thing called American art.
Indeed.
Excuse me, Steve, but the panel's on its way in now.
All right. Thank you, Johnny. You're blindfolded, of course, panel, and therefore you'll just have to take my word for it that our guest star, Vincent Price, is on stage with us. His secret involves a famous painting called The Cardinal's Portrait, and we'll start the questioning with Henry Morgan.
Well, what do I want to know?
You want to know what the secret is.
I know, but there's a painting on stage. What do I want? You told me the name of the painting. Now what am I going for is what I mean.
You're going for broke, Henry.
It's gonna be broke.
It's do or die, kid.
Okay.
What Vincent is doing.
Oh, he's doing something.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I never heard of any painting called The Cardinal's Portrait, okay? So let's start with, is Vincent painting it?
No.
Are you doing anything to the painting?
No.
Are you examining it in any way?
No.
Are you ignoring it?
No.
You've cleared up a lot of ground there, Henry. Anita?
But you're fooling around with that painting, right?
Incidentally, Henry, you may take your mask off now.
Oh.
A little bit, yes.
Yes. Are you touching it?
In a way.
In a way? Are you, are your hands touching it?
That's marvelous.
In a way, yes.
In a way. In a way, your hands are touching it. Are you imitating it?
Yes.
You are?
Yes.
Okay, you may take your blindfold off, Anita. Richard.
I'll make a deal with you, Anita. If you lay them, I'll sell them. How about that?
Sorry.
All right. Vincent, down at the coast here, every year at the Artist Colony, they have living pictures, like 3D pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Are you in a 3D picture?
That's exactly
yes,
it, Richard.
Are you?
Vincent is posing in one of those living pictures, all right, a recreation of the Cardinal's Portrait.
And I'd like to thank my fellow actors who appeared with me. Del Wagner is the monk, and Douglas Palmer is the portrait. And blessings on you, too, Steve.
Thank you very much, Your Eminence.
Thank you.
And our thanks to the Laguna Festival of Arts for making the secret possible. We'll be right back. Now let's meet our next contestant. Could you tell the ladies and gentlemen of the panel your name, sir?
Larry Capune.
Larry Capune. Where do you hail from, Larry?
Balboa Island, California.
Balboa Island. Mr. Capune traveled some time back from Boston down to Miami in quite an unusual way. His secret involves and how he made that trip. And if you'll whisper the secret to me, Mr. Capune, we'll let the world know what it is. Huh. All right. That is interesting. As I say, Mr. Capune's secret concerns the unusual way he got from Boston to Miami, and we'll start the questioning with Pat.
Larry, may I call you Larry?
Fine, yes.
Good. Larry, did it have to do with something on the water?
Yes.
Because you look like a surfer somehow. Did it have to do with a surfboard?
Yes.
That's the secret. It's over. Yep.
Oh, no. That's it?
That's it.
Hard one, huh?
You know, it was funny. I was trying so hard to be clever because I've recently become aware they now have those, am I not right, Larry, those surfboards with sails on them.
Yeah, that's not the way I did it.
No, he actually paddled.
Just on a surfboard.
A real surfboard, yeah.
Grief.
You know.
Here's a picture of him. It's a little out of focus, but then he was moving at the time, of course. Where were you when this picture was taken, Larry?
I was down further south, down along upper Florida when it was taken.
How long did it take you? It
took me 110 days.
Wow. Why did you do it?
Well, definitely the real reason was to try and show kids that you can do something different, you can take a different kind of trip without using the negatives of our society, like, you know, drugs or taking a bottle and going like, you know, this sort of thing.
Good for you.
Also, I attempted it in 65, and I failed miserably because I got arrested in Stone Harbor, New Jersey for not stopping for a lifeguard whistle and inciting a riot. And then...
Wait a minute, how do you incite a riot when you're out on a surfboard?
Well, there was a crowd...
Unless it's at a school of fish or something like that.
It was very far-fetched, I thought. And then in North Carolina, I was scaring some guy's fish, speaking of fish, and he told me if I continued to do so, he was going to kill me, and he started throwing bottles at me and got in the head with a bottle. So that sort of ended the trip.
He was on a dock or in a boat, or where was he?
Yeah, he was on a pier. He owned the pier. He said I was scaring his fish, and I asked him which ones were his, and then he started throwing bottles.
This man actually attacked you?
Yeah, I sued him and got a judgment of $11,000, and when I went by the pier this year, I was covered by the Coast Guard with a helicopter above me, covered, and then a big, launch alongside of me.
Oh, it's certainly something that I'd like my children to do, have bottles thrown at them and be shot at.
Yes.
Oh, I'll send
my
boys north.
How many miles did you cover in this frightening adventure?
2,444 miles.
Wow. I think there's a movie in it somewhere.
Oh, yeah. That's amazing.
And they guessed your secret in 2 seconds.
Yes. Yeah.
Hardly worth the trip.
Yeah.
Well, it was a remarkable adventure. And if there's nothing else the panel cares to add for the record, we will consider this case closed. Court will resume tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. We'll be right back. Thank you very much.